Church family, it's time for a few announcements. If this is your first time here, welcome. If you're here in person for the first time today, please let us know you came by scanning this QR code. This QR code also provides total access to the CBC website, which includes links to today's sermon notes, online giving, prayer requests, and much more. Men, it is time for another men's breakfast. The last one was incredible and had a record-breaking attendance, and for good reason. It was just that amazing. CBC will hold only a few of these a year, so don't miss this one. Look forward to enjoying a hearty breakfast, absorb some biblical teaching, and have a great time hanging out with other like-minded men. Tickets go on sale soon in the Montana lobby.
Just a quick programming note. This Wednesday, we won't be holding midweek. Be sure to join us next week when midweek returns to offer a midweek spiritual pick-me-up. After worship, we'll break into groups for children, students, men's and women's ministries. Together, we'll learn, worship, pray, and gather with our church family. So come join us from 6:30 to 8, beginning in the worship center. Spanish teaching is also available. The CBC Counseling Ministry is holding a special class for step families. The Blending Step Families class helps families with step parents, stepchildren, and siblings come together through biblical teaching and counseling techniques because these families have a unique set of circumstances that are both challenging and a blessing. Through biblical study, parents are taught to navigate through family and relationship issues that are common among blended step families. If you are blessed with such a family, register today. You'll definitely benefit from this class.
The student ministry will be heading to summer camp. CBC middle and high school students are traveling to two different camps. High school students are going to Camp Region in New Mexico, and middle school students are headed to Sacramento, New Mexico for a week of fun activities and outstanding biblical learning. Registration is now open. Register and get a discounted rate while you can. Space is limited and payment plans are available. For more information, visit the booth in the Montana lobby after service. The resurrection of Jesus and his victory over death and sin is the cause for the biggest church celebration of the year and the reason we commemorate Easter. Come celebrate with us on Easter Sunday, March 31st, during 9 and 11 a.m. service, with a Spanish service at 1 p.m. We expect many visitors that day, so we're asking our church family to park and ride, meaning park as far as you can, and we'll provide a shuttle service to our front door. Also, please consider watching from one of our second floor video venues in the West End or the Morgan Theater, leaving seats open for guests. We want our guests to feel welcome and hopefully return, so thank you for your participation. Get the full calendar of this year's events and class schedule. You can also find the latest update on our Church Center mobile app, available for download in the App Store. Cielavista.church is also an excellent way to stay connected, or follow us on Facebook and Instagram at CVCELP. Let's enjoy today's service together.
Hey, my name is Sebastian Joala Escarate. I've been coming to CVC, I want to say off and on, 3 to 4 years. There was a time in my life where I was not doing so well. And I was actually, you know, my phone had just died. And it was funny because I saw the church and I was wondering if there was an outlet. And there was. I was thinking, you know, how funny is it that I just need my phone just to charge just so I could just, you know, make a phone call. And it was funny that I found it here. And I lived down the street too, you know, and I've heard of this church and, you know, I wanted to prove that a person doesn't need church. And by the grace of God, I was terribly wrong. I went to a lot of churches and I would see that they're not biblically based. And that was a big issue for me because their ceremonial churches were not preaching the word. And it was more like a motivational speech telling you that, oh, everything's just gonna be fine. And it is, but sometimes things like passing through a death is not fine. You know, so we need the truth to be told. That way we can be set free. Only a true fellowship of a biblically based church with the Holy Spirit, you know, flowing through it could do something like that. So I've been coming here ever since and trying to get people to come here. I've had my time engaged fully in sin, and I've seen the miraculous love that God has for us. And I think at that moment, you choose. What are you gonna serve? You're gonna choose the world, or are you gonna serve a higher purpose? I heard my shepherd's voice, so I'm here to reclaim that. I'm ready because you know what? I know what it means to get baptized. It means to leave the old self behind, to put God in his rightful place and to let him drive. Because if I drive, I'm gonna mess it up. But since if God is driving, then everything's gonna be all right. And so it's time, you know, in my way and whatever I thought was, you know, whatever the world had me believe, it's not that. And this is the only way, and it's time. You know, my declaration to the world and to myself that, you know, this is where I'm going. This is where I'm trying to go, striving through the narrow gate.
Good morning, church family. Hey, who you saw on the video, that's Jason and Sebastian last week getting baptized. And, you know, today is a very special Sunday as well because this is our second baptism Sunday. And we've got 10 people that are getting baptized. And I want you to know something. These people are not getting baptized to get saved. These people, because they are already saved, they know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. That is why they are getting baptized today, because they are publicly letting our church family know that they are followers of Jesus Christ. So why don't we give them all a hand today? And so here with me, we've got Jason. And Jason, I know that with him, as with everybody else, the leadership team has taken time to hear their stories and to truly know that they believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And so today, Jason, have you already made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? Yes, of course he has, yes. And so my brother, because of that proclamation of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. To see these little ones trusting in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. There's another step right here. Move forward. Okay, and now here we have Violet, and we've heard her story as well. And Violet, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I
Yes, she has. And so because of this proclamation of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. All right, now we've got Renee here. And Renee, have you made that proclamation of trusting in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
All right, and for that proclamation of faith, my brother, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. Now we've got Cameron here, 7 years old, and already made the Lord Jesus Christ her Lord and Savior. So just so they can know, Cameron, have you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? Yes, she has. And because of that proclamation of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, and raised to walk in the newness of life. There's another step. Oh, my goodness. Right. Now we've got Kelly here. Kelly, so that our church family can know, have you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? Yes, she has a step forward. All right. And because of that proclamation of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. All right, church family, now help me welcome Patrick, who also has made Jesus Christ his Lord and Savior. Is that right, Patrick?
Yes.
Yes, and so because of this proclamation of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. And so here we have Chris. Chris, can you tell our church family if you've already made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
Yes, he has. And so because of this proclamation of faith, I now baptize you, Chris, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. Woo. We've got Liz. And Liz, have you made that proclamation of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
And it's because of that proclamation of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. Here. Then we've got Martha. Martha, can you tell our church family, have you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
And it's because of that proclamation of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. Norma, again, as well, can you tell our church family if you've already made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
And it's because of that proclamation of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. John, and if you can tell our church family if you've already made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior.
I have.
And it's because of that proclamation of faith that I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. So there you have it, church family. What a wonderful Sunday celebrating what God is doing in our church family and what God has done in the lives of these people. And so if you could do me a favor and please stand, and we will now have our time of worship.
Well, good morning, church. Heaven is celebrating this morning, so why don't we join them?
You have come and we have found everlasting, now alive to know your freedom, never ending. You alone have made a way for us in your love. You are life. I'm living in the light of my Savior, dancing in the arms of forever. Walking on water, you are life.
Come on, church, give him praise. If God has been good to you this morning or this week, let this song be your prayer today. Let him know how good he is.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Says, all my life you've been faithful. Lord, we praise you this morning. We praise you because you are a good father, a holy father, God, we just sit here right now, God, and we rest for a moment in your presence. Lord, we have hearts of gratitude, Lord, and we just want to say how good you are. We worship you this morning and we praise you because you are worthy of it, Lord. We thank you for Jesus and for the hope that he brings us. Lord, we thank you for your love and your mercy. And it's because of that that we in turn give you back this portion of our praise and our worship and our adoration, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your greatness, God. Amen.
Then sings my soul. How great thou art. We serve such a good God. Psalm 107 says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. And when we give our lives to Christ, we are the benefactors of his great love. Let's give God a shout. Let's give Jesus a shout. You may be seated. I'm going to have our ushers come forward, and we've come to that point in our worship time that we're going to honor God with our first fruits, and it's time for our offering. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this day. We thank you that you are a good and faithful God. And so this morning, Lord Heavenly Father, we ask that as people give and we receive, that you would bless them, Lord Heavenly Father, that you would continue to bless their lives, and we thank you for their steadfast faithfulness to the tithe. And so, Lord God, as we receive this, we would ask that you would just bless this, that we would use it wisely in a way that honors you, Lord Heavenly Father. Thank you once again for all of those who give in their hearts of generosity. This morning, Lord Heavenly Father, I pray for Pastor Larry as he comes up to give a message, the message that you have given him. Lord God, that you would be with him, that you would give him just an enormous amount of endurance and wisdom as he speaks, that the words, Lord Heavenly Father, that he speak would be yours. And so bless our time together. We love you, Lord, and we give you all praise, all glory in the wonderful, powerful, saving name of your son, Jesus. And everyone said, amen. So church family, as the baskets are being passed around, I just have a few announcements. The first would be this coming week, we are not going to have a midweek service. This is Holy Week. So in lieu of the Wednesday night service, we are going to have a Good Friday service. That service starts at 6 p.m. this coming Friday. And I just want to encourage you to get here early because we are expecting a full house. We will have our video venues open for those who can't sit inside of the worship center. But we're going to have a great time of worship, a word, and then we will also be celebrating the Lord's Supper together as a family. So again, I want to encourage you to be here on time. The other thing that I want to remind you of is that as you can see, we are experiencing a great amount of growth in our church, and this is just such a blessing. And so as you sit and you start to get comfortable, if there are chairs between you, I just want to encourage you to kind of do that shuffle and squeeze in just a little bit. So that way, when other people come in, they can make their way easily into the seats. And so I just want to encourage you to please do that. We're coming up on our summertime. And it's hard to believe that winter's gone, spring is here, and summer will be here very soon. And that being said, our youth are going to be going to New Mexico for camp. So if you would, please turn your attention to the screens, and we're going to get some information regarding summer camp for youth. God bless you, and have a great, great service.
Hello, church family. This is Pastor Will. One of my greatest joys of serving your middle and high school students is when they not only understand the saving work of Jesus on the cross, but when they also engage in a deeper understanding of what that means to them right now. To that effect, this year, Cella Vista Student Ministries is hosting two camps in the month of July. Our middle school camp will be hosted on July 8th through 12th for all CVC students who have completed 6th to 8th grade. The camp will be held at Sacramento Camp and Conference Center in Cloudcroft, New Mexico. This middle school camp is designed to answer the question Jesus himself posed to his disciples. Who do you say I am? Students will learn 10 key truths about the person of Jesus while also learning how those truths shape and change everything about us. The goal of the camp is to unpack both who Jesus is and why that matters for us. Our high school camp happens a week later from July 26th through the 30th for all high school students who have completed 9th through 12th grade. We will join John MacArthur's Grace Community Church and other high school ministries nationwide at Glorieta Camp in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And the goal of Camp Regen is not only to see students come to salvation, but to grow them in the knowledge of Jesus himself. Preachers will share and explain God's word and break down the truths of Scripture in the way that applies to high school students and what they're going through. Regardless of which camp your student attends, we believe that you do not have to sacrifice fun to have sound biblical teaching. Just to make sure of that, each week is also loaded with Christ-centered music, small group discipleship, powerful fellowship, and intense team games, outdoor activities to maximize fun throughout the week. Indeed, each camp will be epic and over the top with energy your students will surely not want to miss. Prices for each camp vary, and information is available by visiting the booth outside the Montana entrance or visiting the information page on the Church Center app. Payment plans are available, and church family, if you have the means and the heart to help send a student to camp, we set up within Church Center Giving a drop-down menu where you can select a camp sponsorship. We would be so encouraged if you could help us help our students grow in their faith while creating life-impacting memories. May God bless you and keep you. See you soon.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. Good to see all of you here. Welcome to Palm Sunday at Cielo Vista Church. Holy Week, as many say. And we get ready for a Good Friday service on Friday, and then celebrate the resurrection of Christ next Sunday. But for the believer, every day is Easter. All right? So anyway, Palm Sunday, glad all of you are here today. And you know, when you think about Palm Sunday, just real quick, this is the sermon before the sermon. When you realize Jesus' life, you realize how quickly things can change in 1 week. That quickly. From popularity to the cross. If it happens in Jesus' life, it happens in our lives too. That's why Jesus said, value every day, value every day, value every day. We're in a series called Let's Be Clear. Today I want to talk about good news invitations, the power of an invitation, obviously leading up to Easter, inviting people next week. But not just Easter, but all the time. In his early 20s, Joe was sitting in a barber's chair for the apparent reason of getting a haircut. While the barber was doing his work, he asked Joe a simple, non-threatening question. Seven-word question, the barber asked, will you come to church with me? He didn't ask Joe if Satan was real. He didn't ask Joe to quote the 66 books of the Bible or have him explain the Holy Trinity. He asked Joe a seven-word question, will you come to church with me? At the time, Joe and his wife Sharon, early 20s, struggling in their marriage, had a new baby, splintering marriage, no direction, no hope. Perhaps Joe thought what many think about an invitation to church. What do we have to lose? And so the barbershop invitation accepted. Joe and Sharon and their baby went to a Baptist church, filled out a card with all their information on it. That was on a Wednesday night. And then the next Tuesday evening, a pastor from that Baptist church went to their home, thanked them for being guests at the church that previous Wednesday. But more importantly, this pastor asked Joe and Sharon, do you have a relationship with Christ? Another way to say it is, are you saved? Do you know Christ is your Savior? It's kind of yes or no. That's called evangelism. Well, that night, the pastor opened his Bible, read the passages that explained how sin had separated them from God, but also how forgiveness is available through Christ Jesus, and only God can do that. Only God can save a soul. And so they opened their hearts to the good news, and that night, that Tuesday night, they verbally declared their lostness and humbled themselves under the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Now I'm going to advance the story. Joe and Sharon eventually sensed a calling into ministry. They went to a Bible college, graduated from that Bible college, and in time went to a church in East Texas to do ministry, and then came back to the very Baptist church that they had given, that they'd visited that time, and they were on staff. And then after a season, they moved to Augusta, Maine, and started a brand new church. And then they moved from Augusta, Maine, to become missionaries in Brazil, where they were missionaries in Brazil for 42 years. Now, just to state the obvious, that is a long ways from a barber's chair to becoming missionaries in Brazil. And it all began with a simple 7-word question: will you come to church with me? Well, last month, on Thursday, February the 1st, at 11 a.m. at a church in Houston, I gave the message for Joe's funeral. And I want to show you a picture of Joe and Sharon. There they are. About a year before Joe passed away, and this picture of Sharon in the picture of Joe at his service last month. He was very, very special to me. When I was in middle school, Joe was my Sunday school teacher. And you know, you need a lot of grace to teach middle school boys. I was fine. It was the other heathens in the class that made his work tough. And so Joe was my middle school teacher when I was that age. And on the morning when we moved to San Diego a long time ago, he came over early to pray with us just before we headed out west on Interstate 40. 2 words: only God. Now, what I'd like for you to do is to meet Sharon. Sharon, I don't know if you can stand or not. This is Sharon. And Sharon and Joe's son Perry's here with his daughter Emily. So they're here today. Be seated. Thank you. They live in Houston. I told Sharon at Joe's graduation service, I said, how many years married? 60. Married 60 years. And so I said, hey, Sharon, I said, I just want you to know, when you got married 60 years ago, you may have said something like these words: we're going to stay together in sickness and in health. And I just said to Sharon, work completed, checkered flag, come across the finish line. That's integrity. So I wanted to share that story because many of you have an only God story that began with a simple invitation. Started there. And your life is different today, and your family is different today because someone had the courage and the love to invite you to a church or to tell you of Christ's love or mention how God transforms the lives of people. Someone had the courage to do that. And God peeled back the barriers of your pride or the layers of skepticism or the crushing shame caused by guilt, and you listen to what this person was saying. And here's a story. The Apostle Paul gave a shortened version of his testimony of how he walked into faith, how he was called to faith. And I want you to have your Bibles open to the New Testament book of Titus. Little book back in the New Testament, Titus. If you say, I don't know where that is, go to the index of the Bible, find Titus. It's around 1 and 2 Timothy, and find Titus and go to Titus chapter 3. And this is a shrink-wrapped version of the Apostle Paul's testimony. It's his story. And if you're in Christ, you've got a story. It's different from other people's story, and yet the threads all lead to the cross. That's where they all go to. And so the Apostle Paul in Titus chapter 3, he said this. Titus 3, verse 3, he said, "Once we too were foolish and disobedient." This is his testimony. He said, "We were misled and became slaves to many lusts and pleasures. Our lives were full of envy or evil and envy, and we hated each other." Now, here's the shift of his story, verse 4. "But when God our Savior revealed his kindness and love," he did what? "He saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy," he did what? "He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth and new life through the Holy Spirit." All of the Trinity's involved in the salvation process draws people to Christ. And so if you look at his testimony in verse 3, he said, "We were foolish, we were disobedient, we were misled." Misled is being deceived. Self-deception is an awful way to live life. I think I know it all. You don't know anything. You're deceived. And then he says, "We were slaves." Look at the phrase of this. "We were slaves to many lusts and pleasures." Satan says, when you have lust and you're a slave to pleasure, you have freedom. That's a lie. The greatest freedom there is to be a slave to Christ. That's not a burden, that's a blessing. So foolish, disobedient, misled, slaves, evil, envy, hatred. Hate everybody. They hate me, I hate them. What a fantastic way to live. You want to go marry someone like that? I didn't think so. But then he transitions. He says, "But because of Christ," nothing I did, what Christ did. "He gave us his kindness, his love, and his mercy." Woo, what a great way to live. So just before Jesus ascended to the Father, he gave this commandment to the church, Matthew chapter 28. If you've been in church a number of years, you've read this 100 times, but it's still good. Matthew 28, verse 19, great reminder. Before Jesus leaves, he says, "Now therefore go," or "as you are going, make disciples, followers of all nations." Why do we support nations around the world? Because it says all nations. "Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." Now, what are we to do after people come to Christ? We're to teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. No, you're not alone. Jesus said this, share the gospel, fan the gospel out. So let's just be clear about the good news. It's the good news for all people of all ages, all races, both genders, geographies, and all strata of life. It's good for everybody. And so the Bible reveals a global hope, and it's about the exclusivity of Jesus' words. What were Jesus' exclusive words? In John chapter 14 and verse 60, Jesus said this, "I am the way." Notice the definite article, "the." "I am the way and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Hey, Larry, that sounds too narrow. It's very narrow. You've heard me say this before. People say, I just can't believe that's the only way. I say, you know what? I'm amazed that there even is a way. That's what I'm amazed at. That God the Father would go, there is a way. And it's not your way, Larry. It is my way. And so the gospel is the good news that Jesus saves us by his grace, not by our feeble efforts. And so the gospel is not an invitation to work harder to reach God. If I just do a little more work, God will love me. I can reach God. No, it's not a 30-day program to be a more fabulous you. It's not a redeeming message
on how God worked all, it's a redeeming message about how God worked all things to reach us. And so the gospel is the good news that Jesus came as the first missionary to save lost people like you and me. Now here's the bad news. The bad news is in Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, "For everyone has sinned." We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Maybe you're listening today, you said, "I don't think I've ever sinned." You have. You have. And you will. And sin is what separates us from God. Thank God for the cross. The good news is in Romans chapter 3, verse 23 or 24, that says, "Yet God in his grace," this is a powerful doctrine, "yet God freely in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight." He did this through Christ Jesus. When did he do it? When he freed us from the penalty of our sins. So his grace, his sight, through Christ, he freed us. In verse 24, would say something like this, "I'm incarcerated to sin no more." I'm not incarcerated anymore. Free man. Free woman. How many believers in Jesus have said, "For the first time in my life, I feel free"? You know why you feel free? Because you are free. It's the person bound in sin who's deceived, going, maybe this is life. It's not life, that's bondage. Do you know anyone who's far from God? Anyone in your family far from God, like, they don't even know they're lost? You know the worst kind of being lost is to not know you're lost. That's hideous. So do you know anyone far from God? Far. Do you know anyone trying to please God with their good deeds in life? Do you pray for them? Do you believe God can reach them? Could you invite this person to church with you next week? Could you? 7-word question. Don't be discouraged about people who are far from God and who express no interest in truth, or they're avoiding you, or maybe I've heard this before. You know what? Hey, listen, I'm on the run from God. I always say this: you're not that fast. God will chase you down so fast you don't even know what happened to you. Yeah, but I was a running back in high school. Thank you. Thank you. Now we know. Now we know the glowing report. God will chase you down. He will catch you at the right moment, at the right time. Just ask the apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. Haughty, arrogant, keeper of the law. I know what's going on. And God says, and I've had enough. Wham. Wham is the Hebrew word for whacked. He got whacked on the road to Damascus, and God knows how to whack people better than anyone for his glory. So don't be discouraged about that, because God knows how to reach people, but let's pray for people. The Bible's replete with life change stories that really fuel our encouragement about people who are far, and they're so far, God could never reach them. Oh, God knows how to reach everybody. Oh, yes, he does. Especially family members who are far from God. God knows how. I want you to take your Bibles and look at Luke chapter 8. This is going to be a long story, but oh, how wonderful the Word of God is as we look at it. Luke's Gospel chapter 8. Matthew, Mark, Luke. If you get to John, you've overrun the runway. You're going to need to come back. Matthew, Mark, Luke in the New Testament. Luke's Gospel chapter 8. It's a great story of redemption. It's a great story of hope. It's a great story of salvation. It's a great story of good news. It's a great story that you never can give up on people. So Luke describes it this way. Luke chapter 8, verse 26. A long text we're going to read, but a good text. Great text. Luke 8, verse 26. "So they," that's the disciples of Jesus, "arrived in the region of the Gerasenes." I'll explain that. across from the lake or from the Lake of Galilee. As Jesus was, now I want you to look at this picture. As he's climbing out of the boat, a man who was possessed by demons came out to meet him for a long time. How long? A long time. He had been homeless and naked and living in the tombs outside of the town. You get the picture? Homeless, naked, living in a cemetery. Verse 28, as soon as he saw Jesus, he shrieked and fell down in front of him. Then he screamed, shrieked and screamed. Why are you interfering with me? Notice the me is singular. Jesus, Son of the Most High God. Please, I beg you, don't torture me. Notice the singular nature, me. Verse 29, for Jesus had already commanded the evil spirit to come out of him. This spirit had taken control of the man. If you've ever been around someone demon-possessed, that is a fact. They are not in control. The demon is in control. Even when he was placed under guard and put in chains and shackles, he simply broke them and rushed out into the wilderness completely under the demon's power. This is a demonic man. Now, here's where the life change story happens. Verse 30, Jesus demanded, what is your name? Legion, he replied, for he was filled with many demons. So it went from me to now many demons. Verse 31, the demons kept begging Jesus not to send them into the bottomless pit. So what does that phrase mean? Well, when somebody says, well, I don't believe in hell, I said, well, the demons believe in hell. You're a minority, Sparky. I mean, I don't know how to phrase it any differently. You're in a minority, bro. Did I just say bro? I said bro. You're in a minority. Because here's this demon going, don't send us to the bottomless pit. Verse 32, there happened to be a large herd of pigs feeding on the hillside nearby. And the demons begged him, Jesus, to let them enter the pigs. Man, this story is out there. And so Jesus gave them permission. Verse 33, then the demons came out of the man, plural, demons, came out of the man, and where'd they go? They entered the pigs, and the entire herd plunged down the steep hillside into the lake. This is the Sea of Galilee, actually, and drowned. Now, those of you are going, whoa, Israel, pigs, law, no swine, no bacon. What's going on here? What's happening here? That's not fitting the story. It does fit the story. Because this area of the Gerasenes was a Roman province, and that would be pagan-filled. They could care less about God. They cared about what they wanted to live by. That's why there's so many pigs in that region. Verse 34, when the herdsmen saw it, they fled to the nearby town surrounding countryside, spreading the news as they ran. A crowd soon gathered around Jesus. They saw the man who had been freed from the demons. Now, here's the man he's freed. Now, what does this life change in the man look like? He was sitting, I love this phrase, he was sitting at Jesus' feet, fully clothed and perfectly sane. And they were all afraid. And then those who had seen what happened told the others how the demon-possessed man had been healed, and all the people in the region of the Gerasenes begged Jesus to go away. Only hope they had, and they say, get out of here. And leave them alone, for a great wave of fear swept over them. Now, here's the last scene of the story. Jesus returned to the boat and left, crossing back to the other side of the lake. The man who had been freed from the demons, again, plural, begged to go with him. But Jesus sent him home saying, no, go back to your family and tell them everything God has done
for you. What a great story. And so he went, this demon-possessed man who's now fully clothed, in his right mind, freed from demonic powers, full of the living God. So he went through all the town proclaiming the great things Jesus had done for him. So we all have some people probably know far from God, far, 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 far from God. Pray for him. Invite him to church this week. Not just this week. Invite people all the time. Now, there's a program called Naked and Afraid. This man was the first person on that program. No, you look it up. He's the first person program. See, he went from naked and afraid to clothed and at peace. That's what happened to him. Why? Because Jesus got involved in his life. We hear stories like this. And we're going to say, yeah, but see, that's Jesus and that's the Bible. Or we hear someone talk about the time they shared the gospel and this person came to Christ. And that's just not me. That's just not me. That's for other people. That's just not me. I mean, I'll talk about weather. I'll talk about sports. I'll talk about electric vehicles. I'll talk about a Chinese weather balloon. I'll talk about interest rates. I'll talk about the uptick of crime. I'll talk about a vacation. I'll talk about a new relationship. I'll talk about how I can bench press 500 pounds. I'll talk about weight gain. I'll talk about weight loss. I'll talk about the theory of kale. I'll talk about politics. Long before I would ever invite anyone to church. And the biggest reason forgiven followers of Jesus go mute when it comes to church or the gospel or my faith is the F word, fear. So number one, there's the fear of objection. And here's what people, many Christ followers, they'll default back to is this: I don't know enough. I say, I don't either. But I'm like the guy in John chapter 9 that says, hey, once I was blind, now I see. Here's what my life, I was living in sin, got touched by the master. Now I'm a saved person. Not better than you. I'm different, but I'm not better than you. So a lot of people go, well, I'm in this fear of objections. What if they ask me something about the Bible? I don't know everything about the Bible. No one knows everything about the Bible. But the fear of objection, once I was blind, now I tell your story. What's your story? Could you tell your story? You've got a story. If you're a Christ follower, tell your story. And here's the three things I've used for years, heard a long time ago. I'd ask people, what was your life like prior to Christ? Question number one, what was your life like prior to Christ? Who or what did God use to get you to him? And then how has your life changed? Tell your story. No one can ever take away your story. Somebody who objects, that's not your story. It is my story. I was there. Didn't have to be your story. It's my story. So the fear of objection. That's why a lot of people say, well, I would never do that. Or it's the fear of rejection. If you want to find out about the fear of rejection, Acts chapter 17, Paul's in Athens, preached this great message. He came to the final end of his message, and he says this, some people laughed, and here's the phrasing, they laughed in contempt. That's like mocking someone. What a stupid story. That's not a sane story. What's my story? So some laughed in contempt, Paul said. Others said this, I'd like to hear about this another time. And then the third thing was some believed. The three different things. Laughed in contempt. Can we talk about this next week? I want to hear more. And then the third response is, I believe. You don't know how God's working in your life, some other people's lives. So I want today's message is about amping up the reality that we're going to be around all kinds of people, not just this week, but beyond. We'll have people come and work at our house on something because I can't fix anything. Nothing. I have a butter knife for a tool. I kind of look at it as forced evangelism. Hey, before you walk out the door, can I ask you a question? Kind of before I pay him, can I ask you a question? And so there's this objection piece that people go, I don't know. Tell your story. Then there's the rejection. What if they reject me? They're not rejecting you, friend. You know who they're rejecting? The living God that loves them. The last is the fear of imperfection. So there's objection, rejection, and imperfection. What is that? Let me ask you a question. Was the person who shared Christ with you perfect? No, I didn't think so. No one is, except the one they crucified. We will meet people this week and beyond who may accept our invitation to church. And only God can write the next chapter of that person's life. Now, if somebody says, I'm going to come to church, I'll meet you at 9 o'clock, meet you at 11 o'clock, I'll meet you at 1 o'clock Spanish service, and they've never been here, please do them a great favor. Be here early. Nothing is more awful than to walk in some place going, well, I'm trying to, she invited me. Do you know? I said, no, I don't know. And they're looking around going, let's just get to the car. Let's go. So if you're inviting someone, be there early to greet them. Well, what if many in this church family and watching prioritized inviting people we know and associated with just to church this week? See, all they can do is say no. No. Like, I'm re-roofing my house at 9 o'clock Sunday. I can't come to church with you. God may already be working in their... Here's what I want you to hear. God may already be working in their lives. You come along, I come along with an invitation. And invitations are powerful because God writes the script in their life like he's written the script in your life, in my life. God's writing the script out. So, hey, will you come to church with me? I'm not asking you to stand outside of a store and ring a bell in December. I'm just asking you to come to church with me. That's all I'm asking. And so, four quick things. Number one is this. Learn to tell your story with precision. No one can take away your story. What is your salvation story? Somebody at work, somewhere this week, somebody says, how did you come to know God? Or how do you know you're a Christian? What would you say? What's your story? No one can take away your story. You know what I've discovered about evangelism? I have never argued anyone into the kingdom of God. I've never argued anyone into salvation. Tell your story. Pray this. Number two is pray this. Is this an opportunity? As you're talking to someone, is this an opportunity? Can you tell the person's interested? Number three is pray for lost people. Do you have people around you who are lost? Just pray for them. Maybe somebody was praying for you, somebody's praying for me. And then let's become proficient inviters. Mission of our church is inviting the lost and broken into our Christ-centered journey from what? Empty religion to what? Generational life change. I promise you, friend, we're going to leave here and we're going to go do other things today or this week. And God, in his mercy, in his sovereignty, is going to put you and going to put me around people who are lost and broken. And when he does, and we sense this is a moment to say something, don't hit the mute button. Just simply say, hey, would you come? This is Easter. Would you come to church with me this Sunday at 9, 11, or at 1 in the Spanish service? I'd be very honored to be going to church with you this next Sunday. And become proficient inviters. One day, Max Lucado said this. Great writer. Max says, one day I believe you'll hear the Lord say, I'm so proud that you let me use you. Because of you, others are here today. Would you like to meet them? You get to heaven one day, I get to heaven one day, and there's somebody who shared Christ with you, somebody shared Christ with me. Would you like to meet them? Thousands of Brazilian people know Christ today because Joe and Sharon Flippin said, we're going to go to Brazil. We're going to pack up enough stuff, and we're going to go to Brazil, and we're going to learn Portuguese, and we're going to tell people about Christ. And Sharon, one day, you get to heaven, and Joe and all of us get to heaven. There'll be Brazilian people there who would say, because you went, we're here. God in his wisdom and his sovereignty, we're here because you went. And God challenged us because of your ministry. Churches were planted. The people we meet this week may eagerly accept an invitation. Why? Because we don't know how God is already working in their lives. We may meet them in a bank, at work, some God-ordained encounter, and maybe even a barbershop. Why? God is always at work. Always at work. And that's what Henry Blackaby said. Prayer partners, if you'd join me here. Henry Blackaby, in his book Experiencing God, says this: find out what God is doing and join him. Find out what God's doing in a conversation. Speak up. Somebody spoke up to you and to me. Aren't we glad they did? From a barber shop to Brazil. That's a long ways. You know how it started? With a 7-word question. Will you come to church with me? Started there. God is at work all around us. Let's join him. Let's join him, okay? Prayer partners are here. Maybe you want to come forward in these prayer partners and say this: I want to give my life to Christ today. I have been on the do plan. I'm trying to do something that's going to make God love me more. And I say this: get off the do plan. It's a hopeless plan. Get on the done plan. It's been done for you and for me. Get on that plan. You won't regret it. Walk to any of these prayer partners and say this: today, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. Maybe some of you want to come and just pray. Say, hey, God, I want to come and pray with some prayer partners. I've got a mom or a dad or a son or a daughter or someone I love who's far from God. Will you join me in prayer for them? Or just would you pray that God will use me this week to take the mute button off my life and speak up in boldness for the Savior? All they can do is say no. That's all they can do. Okay? Thanks for being good listeners today. Weren't the baptisms wonderful? Have more next hour. So thanks, God. Let's stand together for a closing prayer. What a wonderful day to, what a wonderful time to start the week. And I love being with you. Love being with you. Father, thank you for bringing us together today. Thank you for faithful people like Joe and Sharon. God, I ask you that you would raise up a lot of Joe and Sharons from this church who will scatter all over the world to tell people about the saving gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the person who told me. I pray that this week we'll take the mute button off and be great proclaimers. Just invite a lot of people. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for our sins. Thank you that you rode into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday and you didn't quit. And when it was hard, you prayed and you died for me. I pray that people will do now what they'll be glad they did when they stand before you. In the Lord's name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks, everybody. Glad you came.